Please welcome the CEO and founder of VK.com, Pavel Durov. And we'll be joined on stage by Alexia Sopsis, co-editor of Tempo.
VK is not a clone of Facebook, it's different in many ways. And there were lots of technologies that appeared first in VK and then appeared on Facebook. And VK is popular among Russian people and Ukrainian people, all those post-Soviet countries, because it's faster, it's easier to use, and it has more functionality that is required by post-Soviet population. So, I don't think that this remark of Marx has been accurate.
You have said that you want VK to be a global company. Does that mean that you're going to start looking at the US market?
Well, you know, it's not an aim, it's not a goal to expand, not only the cost. We're just trying to do some useful product. Translate it into other languages and see if it's interesting. It seems interesting in other areas. So, if it happens in a natural way, we'll be happy. If it doesn't, we won't be worrying about that.
You actually canceled your IPO because Facebook sent a bad market signal. Now that it's sending a good market signal, is a VK IPO back on the table?
Yeah.
When?
Well, it's too early to decide, but definitely the situation on the market is good for that.
So another thing that Zach brought up in his talk was the illegal file downloads on VK. What is your answer to that? That a lot of the material on VK Kontakte is illegal music downloads or MP3s or file sharing that is doing justice to copyright.
So it's true, yeah. Well, this is just not true because you can't download music or video on VK. You can't do that. There's a streaming service and it's DMCA compliant. Their right holders have any complaint about that, they could send us, we'll delete the item and the user will not be able to upload it again. Certainly we've been in the process of negotiation with Sony Music Universal and to try to come up with ways how they could earn money from our streaming service. We're all quite optimistic about that. I think we come up with a solution for several months or so.
Does that mean you're working on your own Spotify esque music service through the game?
You could say so.
So, in addition to VK, and you have a very busy life from what I've read, you're working on a new thing, Telegram.
Yeah.
And explain a little what this is.
Well, Telegram started as a non-profit research. We asked ourselves a question. Why when it comes to messaging, you have either an easy to use and fast solution, or you have a secure solution. It doesn't combine. You can't have a secure messaging system which is fast and easy to use. And we began to explore that. There was a team dedicated to that research. And well, it seemed that it was successful. And the guys came up with a messaging system that is faster than the fastest messenger on the market. And with that, it had military-grade encryption, which also includes end-to-end encryption and very secure options. But you know, you can say it's a business project or something that could attract investments because it's a non-profit, it's open source, it's available for anybody to use or to expect to review. So it's more like a set of technologies and an app that you can download from an iPhone, Android. It's the best download.
So it's not going to compete with VK because it's not a non-profit.
No, it won't compete with VK for several reasons. First, this is not a social network, it's a messaging system, and it's completely different demographics. It's not translated to Russian, it's not doesn't have any social functionality. VK includes all the functionality of Telegram, except for the encryption part, which some of our shareholders wouldn't like to see in VK.
Which year? The government ones?
Well, you know...
United Capital Partners.
I think both of our shareholders, both of our major shareholders have some ties to the government. So, in this case, I'm not sure about the United Capital Partners, but I'm sure about made it clear that they don't want this kind of encryption to be implemented at VK because it could raise concern. They said that HTTPS is enough for this product. But you know, everything can change. We discussed that. This is what I heard of at the last board meeting.
Could you? I think explain what specifically they're concerned about if you do end encryption on the VK message.
I think. It could be perceived in one way. I mean, we're trying to do something. Yeah, be regarded as aggressive towards the government, maybe like that. It's hard to guess.
So, what is your relationship exactly with the government? You've had some charges against you. VK was in a contentious relationship and then Rail.ru offered to buy you and then they ended up buying just shares. How does your contact day relate with the product, if at all? Is it a happy relationship? Is it?
I think there are no direct connections between me and the government. So when some of our shareholders had some. You know, I think that I'm doing some useful things for the country as well. We're trying to develop Russian IT to set an example for the younger generation. So I don't think that the government has any reasons to complain about my activities. Of course, we've had some incidents in the past. But these past events were also made for the best of the country. So I don't think that there's any concern that should be raised by the government.
Did you think that the traffic charges against you were fair?
Not for so. Well, the traffic charges are more public relations thing. It happened this April when a very major Russian TV channel a story about me allegedly doing something wrong, and then all the accusations were lifted. they made a research, they investigated the records of cameras and saw that I was not guilty of what the TV channels tried to accuse me. I think this story is all over, but I had a very interesting period in my life. For about 2 months, I took a vacation to travel across Europe because I was trying to figure out what to do next because I wasn't sure what was the cause of this activity in the press.
Is this when you started working on Telegram?
Telegram is a research project that has been going for some time. It's over 1 year. My brother did a lot of research in that. He created a new data protocol that would be highly secure, fast, and decentralized. So this was a pretty unique thing he did. But if we are talking about the apps, the Telegram app, yes, that's the approximate time.
Interesting. So what are the advantages of Telegram versus WhatsApp, for example, or Facebook?
Well, if we compare Telegram to WhatsApp, then there are several points that made it very different. It has military-grade security and protection, and it's something very different from WhatsApp in that respect. So, you could monitor traffic, WhatsApp traffic, and easily decrypt the messages.
On WhatsApp.
Telegram is not very easy to look at. From what we are seeing, it's impossible, especially if you use end-to-end encryption connections. It's decentralized. We built a big infrastructure for that. It has lots of servers spread all over the world. And so we use the closest one to you to communicate with your local friends. And it's completely open. We open source the projects. The project is fully documented. The API is an open platform. Anybody could use it to build their own secure messenger. Also, it's fast. It's cloud-based. It's a differentiation feature, I guess, from WhatsApp. You can access your WhatsApp messages from several devices once you have to choose. Now, this one is cloud-based. You can do that. It's completely free.
What is going on the right over there?
Sorry?
What's that? Looking at that.
Well, yeah, our artist is crazy, as is the rest of our team.
So, I'm on Telegram and I'm doing something like that to my bear friend. And the government, whether it's the NSA, asks you guys for my data. What do you say to the NSA? Let's say Telegram is very popular in the US, it becomes extremely popular in the US, and I'm doing that, and somehow that's a form of terrorism. And the NSA asks you, I want Alexei's data. What do you say?
Well, if you use end-to-end encryption, you have no data to provide. Even our own system administrator can't access the private data users. And you can review the algorithms that we use, review the open source, and check that, see that the NSA can do the same thing, and be sure that we are not trying to fool them.
Have you had any requests so far?
Not yet.
Has been contact they had requests? Either the NSA or the Russian government, or the Belarusian government?
It's strange that we didn't have any requests from NSA because we know we had this page going with this terrorist from Boston, playing this marathon movie. So this guy was a user of VK and nobody asked us to provide anything about him.
I think they might ask. I think you will be getting a phone call.
They could, but you know, we are a Russian company. We don't have to comply with the sales.
But you do have to comply with the Russian government, which, according to you, I called Abel this weekend, and the first thing he said to me on the phone was, I just want you to know that this phone call is being recorded by the Russian government, so say hi.
It should be sure. Otherwise, it would mean polite.
So what are your views on internet privacy, coming from a place where every phone call is recorded?
Well, first of all, I think that almost everywhere the situation is the same. Russia is not exception. The difference of Eastern Europe is that things are more visible there, it's straightforward. So the governments in post-Soviet countries are not ashamed of the fact that they want to access data. The situation is less transparent in the United States and the world, where the governments claim that privacy is sacred, and then we receive information that it's not exactly so. And from time to time, they use this data for unspecified purposes. So I think that transparency is a key thing here. We should be able to understand what is being monitored and why, and by whom, on which occasions. That's number first. And, number second, my belief is that this is our responsibility as IT businessmen, engineers, to come up with technologies that would make this possible. I mean, this total surveillance of everybody.
Is there any specific companies you'd like to call out for not having come up with technologies to make this possible?
You know, I think that the companies that are most popular in private communication should do that. Number one company in terms of number of messages, it's WhatsApp. So I would personally be very happy and grateful for them if they would introduce transparent and encryption algorithms in their messenger. That'd be great.
And other than WhatsApp?
Well, certainly you have a big list of players in this market. Viber is very popular place where I live, so they could come up with a better encryption, I guess. But, you know, everybody, this field was neglected for so much time. It seemed that the priorities were different. Everybody wanted to come up with a new product, and security was number 10 priority, but it was just wrong.
So, you think that if the U.S. government was just transparent about tracking, it would be okay? If I knew as an American citizen that my phone calls would be recorded, it would be okay for them to report my phone calls? Or do you think that even the phone call recording condition?
Well, I think the first thing, they have to be transparent about this. Then it should become a discussion and debate among the population, activists, everybody, security experts. And the society has to decide whether they are okay with the big brother, or the big brother should be not that big, and then come up with a solution. Because right now, there's a lack of information about that. So it's hard to solve the problem if we don't know how severe the problem is.
Do you think that we as digital global citizens have a right to privacy in online communication? That's something that's a right, like the right to free speech or to bear arms in the U.S.?
Sure. I think that this is the right that is guaranteed by most of the constitutions in Europe, and I believe in the United States. I think that the right for privacy is sacred.
It's a search and seizure, right?
Sorry?
It's a stipulation that there's no illegal search and seizure. I think that's what that falls on.
Well, in Russia, there is an article in the Constitution that private correspondence should not be should be secret. Unless it was otherwise decided by a court. There was a court decision. Well, my personal view on that is that terrorist threat cannot be a pretext, a reason to violate the privacy of everybody. I mean, if you look at the statistics, there are more people every day dying from accidents of their mothers. Fall on the floor because it was wet on the floor and they hit their heads and die. And there are thousands more of these people. There are more of these people than of victims of terrorist attacks. But you know, so this is a bigger threat than terrorism statistics. If the governments decide to provide us with a safe solution, set up surveillance cameras in our bathrooms for our own security. Well, I think
what's going on over there.
So, I think we would oppose that. My personal view is that you cannot use terrorism as a pretext to do that. But this is my personal view, and I think every society should have a discussion and decide what is best for them. But I'm sure North Koreans might have other
plans. Have you met with Snowden? He's in St. Petersburg, I think. And you offered him a job. Did you hear from him about the offer? You offered him a job doing privacy at VK, which seems like something you could do.
No, unfortunately, I haven't seen him. Yeah, we did offer him a job because we would certainly be happy to consult with him and to make his talent useful for us. He's a very interesting and brave person, one of my personal heroes, so I would be happy to meet him in person. But now, to answer your question, we haven't heard.
Why is he one of your personal heroes?
Why is he my... Well, I think that this guy had to sacrifice a big part of his life to let us know about the fact that we were being spied on. I understand that there are many conservative, patriotic people here in America who say Snowden is a traitor because he set an obstacle. Now we can't spy on the rest of the world that easily. You know, I was the one of these people who were probably spied on, and I'm not happy about the fact that my rights were violated without me even knowing that. So I'm personally grateful for him that he let us know about what was happening.
Now that you know, what are you going to do? Just use Telegram more? Now that you know that that's a possibility, what's changed?
Well, Telegram is just a tiny project. What I hope is that more and more companies and technologies will arise. The companies with the understanding of the fact that we should protect our privacy. We can do it. We could develop encryption mechanisms. We could check whether the tools that we're using now are secure or not, and proceed with that. I think that everything's off in our hands, and we can come up with the encrypted messaging, encrypted voice over IP, encrypted social networking, all things like that.
Do you think Mark Zuckerberg, running probably the most popular social network on Earth, needs to take all of this stuff into account?
It would be great if he did. I would be happy. But you know, I guess he might have other priorities.
Thank you. Thank you for that.
Thank you.